It's half past 8.
It's 8:30 New York time. Time to wake up America and stump the experts. Each week at this time, Lucky Strike throws a coast-to-coast party at which you and four experts provide the entertainment. For every question we use, Lucky Strike pays out $10 plus a copy of the new Information Please quiz book. If your question stumps us, you get $25 more, plus a 24-volume set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Send your questions to Information Please, 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. If our editorial staff edits your questions a bit, don't fret over it. In case of similarity, we'll have to be sole judge of who shall be paid, and all questions become the property of Information Please. And I'll light up a lucky strike as I present our master of ceremonies, the literary critic of the New Yorker magazine, Clifton Fadiman. Mr. Fadiman.
Ladies and gentlemen, Information Please, as you know, is completely spontaneous and unrehearsed. Tonight, that pair of veterans is back on the job, the lyrist and New York Post conning tower man, Franklin P. Adams, and his learned sidekick, the naturalizing sports expert, Mr. John Kieran. Our two guests are both distinguished educators, Professor Lyman Bryson of Columbia University, known to millions as the director of the People's Platform, and the president of Vassar College, Dr. Henry Noble McCracken. Now remember, for each question missed, Lucky Strike rings up $25. And that's paid out to the sender, plus 24 volumes of the Encyclopedia Britannica. We're off with a question coming to us from Mr. L.V. Espy of Prineville, Oregon. This is about famous sons. Who is or was the son of the following? Get 3 out of 4. The son of Mary Ball, B-A-L-L. Who is or was the son of Mary Ball? I have them stumped. Right off the reel. The son of Mary Ball, Mr.
Is Mary Ball Mrs. Custis?
Are you asking
Lady?
Me?
Yes.
You just tell me. To whom did Mary Ball give birth, who later became a reasonably celebrated person? Well, the son of Mary Ball became, later on, in due time, the father of his country, George Washington.
George Washington.
Yes, that's right. George Washington was the son of Mary Ball. I have to count that as one wrong. Now we have to get the next three right.
Well, who? I said Custis. That was, that wasn't quite right.
No, not quite right. Got into the family, but that's about all.
That was Mrs. George Washington.
That's right. That's right. Who is or was the son of Agrippina the Younger? The son of Agrippina the Younger, Dr. McCracken.
Nero.
Nero, yes, the Emperor Nero. I say Agrippina the Younger. Apparently there was an Agrippina the Elder, I should judge.
That was the grandfather.
Agrippina the Elder also produced a very famous son. Any idea?
Caligula?
That's right, Mr. Kieran. Caligula is correct. That's extra. You didn't have to answer that, Mr. Kieran. Get an extra point for that. Who was the son of Letizia Ramolino? Letizia Ramolino.
Oh.
Mr. Kieran?
Well, of course, that's an Italian. Was that one of the popes?
No. Oh, no.
Well, and it must be Mussolini.
No, no.
Leonardo da Vinci.
No. A very famous Italian, as a matter of fact, Napoleon Bonaparte. His mother was Letizia Ramolino. That gives us 2 sons wrong out of 4. How about this one? Who is or was the son of Joe Yule? Y-U-L-E. The son of Joe Yule. No idea, gentlemen? I must say your genealogy is defective. The son of Joe Yule is Mickey Rooney, who was born Joe Yule, Jr. That gives us 3 wrong out of 4, which is quite insufficient, and sends $25 to Mr. Espy, plus a set of the Encyclopedia Britannica, courtesy of Lucky Strike. Now, see whether you can do any better on this one. I think this is much easier. Here's one from F.N. Sanford of Maplewood, New Jersey. It's about elopements, gentlemen. Name the character in literature who eloped with a poet and a dog in literature or literary history. Mr. Kieran.
Elizabeth Barrett Browning.
Yes, that's quite right. What was the dog's name?
Flush.
Gee. A straight flush from all you gentlemen. That's right. And the man she eloped with, of course, was...
Robert Browning.
Robert Browning, quite right. Now, who eloped with a man and a bucket? Mr. Kieran.
A young lady from Pawtucket. No, not
Nantucket.
Nantucket, yes. Can you give us her whole saga?
Was a young lady of Nantucket. There was no man of Nantucket who kept all his gold in a bucket. He had a daughter named Nan who ran off with a man, and as for the bucket, Nantucket.
Attaboy. That's perfect.
Mr. Kieran now qualifies as an elopement expert. How about this one? Who eloped with a man and a horse? A man and a horse. Mr. Dr. McCracken.
The bride of young Lochinvar.
Yes, the bride of young Lochinvar. What was her name?
Fair Ellen.
Ellen.
Yes, no. I think Fair was just sort of attached to her name.
Fair W. Ellen was her name.
You make it sound very convincing, but if you wanted to look her up in the telephone book, you'd have to look her up under the name of Netherby. Ellen Netherby. Netherby. Oh. Ellen Netherby, who ran off with a man and a horse. The man being young Lochinvar. Well, that gives us three elopements out of three. How about this one from Marie Wilmot of Akron, Ohio? Get three out of four. Gentlemen, let us assume that you are living in the year 1776, and you wanted the following things done. Which signer of the Declaration of Independence would you call on to help you? If, for example, you wanted a book published. Dr. McCracken.
Benjamin Franklin.
Benjamin Franklin. I don't know whether he was the first... he was one of the first successful book publishers, I suppose, in this country. Now, suppose you wanted a doctor and wanted to use only a signer of the Declaration of Independence. A doctor. Mr. Kieran.
I'm not quite sure. Dr. Warren?
No, I don't know whether Dr. Warren was a signer.
Well, that's what I was in doubt about.
I think he was a doctor, all right.
He was a doctor.
Yes,
good
he was.
One, I hear.
Dr. Benjamin Franklin.
No.
They did call him Dr. Franklin, as Mr. Adams reminds us, but of course he wasn't a real M.D. Mr. Bryson, did you have an idea there?
Yes, but I gave it up.
It might have been right. Dr. McCracken?
Dr. Rush.
Dr. Rush is quite right.
Benjamin Rush.
Benjamin Rush, Mr. Adams, that's quite right. There were three other doctors, Josiah Bartlett, Lyman Hall, and Matthew Thornton. Now, suppose you wanted to buy some tea. Which signer of the Declaration of Independence would you apply to?
T. Jefferson.
A sprightly fellow you are, Mr. Adam. I've got to get the correct answer in addition to the funny one. Dr. McCracken?
Well, Samuel Adams, because he must have saved some of the tea out of Boston Harbor.
Well, that's a slick answer, but he wasn't a merchant as John Hancock was. John Hancock.
Jen Hancock was an insurance
agent. He was an insurance agent.
That's the one you boys know. And finally, gentlemen, if you wanted to write a song, to whom would you apply? And wanted to get a signer of the Declaration to write it for you. Write a song. Dr. McCracken, was that your hand up?
Freneau?
I beg your pardon?
I don't think Freneau signed the Declaration.
No, he did not.
No.
I don't think he wrote music. I'm not certain about
that. Oh, I think you wanted...
Must have been Button Gwinnett.
I beg pardon?
Must have been Button Gwinnett.
No, that's if you wanted to collect signatures. You would get his signature, but...
That's a good name.
A very good name. The answer would be Francis Hopkinson, who was our first American poet-composer. He's also remembered because very probably, though we're not sure, he designed
Mr. Smith
the American
was named
flag.
After him.
Mr. Smith?
Francis Hopkinson Smith
is quite right. But that gives us two wrong out of four and sends $25 to Marie Wilmot, plus a set of the encyclopedia. And Lucky Strike is losing rapidly and cheerfully so far this evening. Here's one from H.W. Mallory of San Leandro, California. Get two out of three. Oh, gosh, this is another hard one. Quote the line that precedes each of these lines. This is very tough. The first is, to throw a perfume on the violet. What's the line that goes before it? Mr. Kieran.
To paint the lily, to gild refined gold. Isn't that right?
That's right.
That's from... King John, I believe,
it written is right.
By Shakespeare, W. Shakespeare.
Yes. To gild refined gold, to paint the lily, which is the famous line, and not very many people remember the next one, as Mr. Kieran did, to throw a perfume on the violet. Now, how about this one? This gets harder, Mr. Kieran. A little month, or ere those shoes were old. What's the line that comes before that? A little month, or ere those shoes were old. Mr. Kieran?
Well, of course, it's Hamlet.
It is indeed.
And, Constancy, thy name is woman, or something like that.
Yes, you've got everything but the right name.
Frailty.
Yes, that's right. Anna W. Frailty, thy name is woman. That's quite right. Now, here is another one. I think this gets tougher. 'Twas mine, 'tis his, and has been slave to thousands. I have several hands. Dr. McCracken, was your hand up? Just tentative. Mr. Adams.
Who steals my purse steals trash.
That's quite right. That's exactly right, Mr. Adams. And what's it from?
Macbeth.
No, choose another. Keep going. Mr. Kieran.
It's Iago. Othello.
Iago and Othello, yes. Well, that gives us 3 out of 3. I thought you'd flop on that one, gentlemen. You're very good. Mr. Ralph Murray of Maplewood, New Jersey, sends this one in. Get 2 out of 3 again. I'm going to give you several groups of names. In each group that I give you, one of these names is out of place. It just doesn't belong in the group. Which one is it and why? Here's the first group. Austerlitz, Marengo, Jena, Leipzig. Which of those names doesn't belong with the other three? Dr. McCracken?
Marengo.
Why?
Because it was not fought in the Napoleonic Wars.
Marengo was not fought in the Napoleonic Wars? I think it was. Dr. Bryson?
Well, the others are in Germany. Reason. It's in Italy, and the other three are in Germany.
That might be. I won't accept that one. That's not really what distinguishes the one from the other. Mr. Kieran?
I don't recognize the Battle of Leipzig. I recognize Jena and Marengo and Austerlitz as Napoleonic victories.
Well, that's the
whole Leipzig
point.
Was the great defeat of Napoleon.
I beg pardon?
Leipzig was the great defeat of Napoleon
exactly
by the Allies.
That's exactly right, Dr. McCracken, and that's the point. Leipzig was the only one of those battles that Napoleon lost. It preceded his exile to Elba. Mm. I should like to count you right, Dr. McCracken, but you came in just a little late on that, so I have to count you wrong. You know, you must raise your hand at once, Dr. McCracken, get the right answer. You know how it is in the classroom yourself. Now, here's another set of names. Actium, Lepanto, the Mon, Trafalgar. Which one of those is out of place? Dr. Bryson.
Well, I think Trafalgar is a naval battle.
Yeah?
The others are land battles.
Are they?
Aren't they?
Mr. Kieran?
You're calling on me?
I am indeed.
The Marne was a land battle across the river. The other three were naval battles.
Yes, that's right. The Battle of the Marne is the only one that was fought on land. The others are all famous naval battles, Actium, Lepanto, and Trafalgar. We have to count that wrong. You raised your hand too quickly, Mr. Bryson. Now you have a chance to retrieve yourself, though not to get the $25 back that we're going to lose. Emilie, Yvette, Cécile, Annette. Which of those doesn't belong where it is? Mr. Adams.
One of them is not one of the Dions.
Which one?
Tell it over.
I will indeed. Emilie, Yvette, Cécile, Annette. How about it, Mr. Adams? The old Dion expert. Dr. McCracken.
Yvette.
Why not?
She's not one of the...
She's not one of the Dion quintuplets. Does she remind you of any one of them? Does her name remind you of any of them? Mr. Bryson.
There's an Yvonne, isn't there?
Yes, it should be Yvonne, not Yvette. By the way, I didn't name the fifth of the Quins. What is the last of them?
Say the four again.
Emilie, Yvonne now, Cécile, Annette.
There's one beginning with M.
Yes, and how does it go on? You could just call her M.
Marie.
Dion. Marie is right, Mr. Adams, thank you. Well, I'm afraid that loses us $25 in an Encyclopedia Britannica. Courtesy of Lucky Strike.
$5
Quinn. How about this one, gentlemen, from Max Deutsch of St. Louis, Missouri. Can you give me 3 literary or play titles that indicate a character's financial condition? Titles of plays or books or novels that indicate whether a man is poor or rich or in between. Mr. Bryson.
Of course, there's Molière's play, The Miser, L'Avare.
That's a very good one. I'll take that. Mr. Adams.
The Million Pound Banknote by Mark Twain.
Million-pound banknote by Mark Twain, that's correct. Very good. I don't know whom it would belong to, but I'll accept that as a proper title. Dr. McCracken.
Ready Money.
Ready Money is good. It's a farce, isn't it? Mr. Kieran?
The 12-pound look.
The 12-pound look by James Barry is a very good one. Well, we have more than 3 or 4. Mr. Bryson.
Brewster's Millions.
Brewster's Millions is a very good one. Mr. Adams.
Very Hard Cash.
By Charles Reed.
By Charles Reed.
I think it's just Hard Cash. Always exaggerated.
Very hard cash.
Is it very hard cash? Are you sure it isn't hard cash, Dr.
Very
McCracken?
Hard cash.
You wouldn't like to make a small bet on that, would you?
Yes, I would.
All right.
Bet some very hard cash on
that. All right. well, that was correctly done. Now, so far, Lucky Strike has paid out $75 and 3 sets of the Encyclopedia Britannica. And now Mr. Cross, ever a word saver, tells us 5 words that are worth 1,000.
Yes, Mr. Fadiman, the 5 words are, Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. And this simple statement of fact is important to every smoker, for whatever qualities you want in a cigarette depend on the tobacco that goes into it. The better the leaf, the better the smoke, and the more real enjoyment for you. Well, reports from market after market all over the South show that Lucky's pay the price to get the finer, the lighter, the naturally milder tobaccos. For example, at Lawrenceville, Virginia last season, the American Tobacco Company paid 32% more per pound for the tobacco it bought for its cigarettes and other tobacco products. Yes, 32% above the average market price paid for all the various types and grades of tobacco sold there. And the best we bought goes into Lucky's. So, smokers, that's why Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. Mr. Fadiman, doesn't that say just about everything?
Mr. Cross, it covers the subject with most admirable brevity. Just 57 seconds. And now we go on with the second half of the program this evening, opening with a question from Eileen Roosh of Minocqua, Wisconsin. Get 2 out of 3, if you can. Each of these men that I shall name was or is an intimate friend of a famous man. Name the famous friend. The first, I think, is rather easy. William Herndon. Famous friend, Dr. McCracken.
Abraham Lincoln.
Yes, we had everybody's hand up on that. Abraham Lincoln. Herndon was what, in what relation to Abraham Lincoln?
He was his law partner.
He was his law partner.
He wrote
and,
his biography.
Collected materials for his life and wrote a biography. Arthur Henry Hallam, H-A-L-L-A-M, Mr. Bryson.
He was a friend of Tennyson.
He was a friend of Alfred Lord Tennyson, yes. Now, he was commemorated by Tennyson in what
Tennyson
point?
Wrote In Memoriam.
In Memoriam, to commemorate his friendship with Pelham. Homer Brown. Homer Brown. Intimate friend of a famous man. Homer Brown. I've never seen a blanker look. Homer Brown is the friend of Henry Aldrich, of the Aldrich family. I think you all might know that. Just slipped by on that with 2 out of 3. How about this one from Mabel F. Moore of St. Paul, Minnesota? Who were the eyewitnesses of these incidents? In some cases, there was just one eyewitness, in some cases, more than one. Get 3 out of 4. Who witnessed the suicide of Titwillow? The suicide of Titwillow. Mr. Bryson.
The wandering minstrel witnessed the suicide.
His name being? We like to have names, if not addresses.
Well, it's in the Mikado.
He did not.
Nanki Poo.
That's the wrong answer, isn't it? Who did witness the... Mr. Adams, who was the witness of the suicide of Titwillow?
Coco.
Coco is right. Mr. Adams, you should have had your hand up. Quickly.
I did. And didn't do much good.
Who witnessed the fight between the gingham dog and the calico cat? Famous and sanguinary encounter, Mr. Kieran?
The China plate, I think, wasn't it? Or
that was
like
one
that.
Of the eyewitnesses, the Chinese plate.
Chinese
and there's
plate.
Another. The story comes from whom? Who?
Eugene Field.
Eugene Field, Mr. Adams.
I still never have read that piece.
Well, would you like to know the name of it so that you can look it up?
Well, I have one witness. Does that get us by?
I think it'll get you by, Mr. Kieran. The old Dutch clock was the other witness. The old Dutch clock and the Chinese plate witnessed the fight between the gingham dog and the calico cat. A matter of, on the whole, very little importance. Who were the eyewitnesses of the appearances of the ghost of Hamlet's father? There's a complicated answer on this one. Dr. McCracken, want to start us off?
Horatio.
Horatio is right.
And the two sentries.
Yes, their names? We love names on this program. Names, dates. Mr. Kieran?
One was Marcellus.
First sentry and second sentry.
Marcellus was one.
Yes, Marcellus is one. And the other one was...
Bernardino. Bernardo,
that's right. Marcellus.
He's the fellow that said, "'Tis bitter cold and I am sick at heart."
Is that the chap?
No.
There was one other eyewitness. None of you have
Hamlet.
Known Hamlet, Mr. Kieran, that's quite right. Who witnessed the death of Cock Robin? Mr. Adams.
I said the sparrow.
Wait a minute. Hold on. You're too impulsive.
The death?
Yes, the death.
I said the fly with my little eye.
Who saw him die? I said the fly. Let's see. We seem to have got... just about got by on that one, I think. How about this one from H.S. Howard of Hollywood, California? If each of these men followed the profession that his name seemed to imply, what would he be doing? His last name, I mean. The first is Happy Chandler. Mr. Bryson.
You'd be making candles.
Yes, Chandler is a candle maker originally. It's come to mean what?
A dealer in candles and that kind of gear.
For ships.
Know? Yes, a ship chandler is one who deals in ship's gear of all sorts. Groceries, provisions, raincoats, and all that sort of thing. Who is Happy Chandler, by the way?
He's a Kentucky statesman.
Yes.
United States Senator.
Former governor.
Yes, a congressman. How about Art Fletcher? Art Fletcher. If Art Fletcher, Mr. Bryson?
He'd be an arrow maker.
An arrow maker, yes. A Fletcher is one who fletches arrows. Fletches or feathers arrows.
Ask him who he is.
And I bet he doesn't know, Mr. Kieran. Mr. Bryson, who is Art Fletcher?
What's his first name?
Art. Arthur.
I don't know.
Time is fleeting, by the way.
I don't know.
He's now a coach.
He's a baseball player. Can you identify him further, Mr. Kieran?
Yes, he's the baseball coach of the Yankees, assistant to Joe McCarthy, the manager.
And will you let him know, Mr. Kieran, what his last name means in case he doesn't happen to know himself?
I think he knows. He knows a lot, that fellow.
All right. I wasn't questioning his knowledge. Now, we have the name William Brewster. Originally, Dr. McCracken, William Brewster?
He brewed beer.
You're almost right. You're almost right. A Brewster was not a brewer, but a female brewer. That's why they called her a Brewster. Who was William Brewster, Dr. McCracken?
He was the minister of the Mayflower.
Yes, one of the early American colonists. That's quite right. Well, we seem to have done all right on that one. How about... this is right up the alleys of Mr. Bryson and Dr. McCracken. It comes from Virginia Gilbert of Salinas, California, and it's about school teachers. Not real ones, such as we have on this program tonight, but imaginary ones. Now, the first one, there was a busybody school teacher who was a great success as a detective. Who is that? There are going to be three of these. I had a feeling you wouldn't know this. Mr. Adams?
Was that a Chesterton...
Father Brown? No, Father Brown was not a schoolteacher, as one can tell from his title. Hildegard Withers in the stories by Stuart Palmer, a famous detective in a series of detective stories. That gives us one wrong. Now, this school mom started a school in her own home. This is an imaginary or fictional one, Mr. Adams.
That is whoever the Ethel Barrymore was in The Corn is Green.
That's exactly right, Mr. Adams, yes. The part of Miss Moffat, I think. Dr. McCracken, were you going to add something to that?
Well, I was going to say that Joe and Little Women.
Did she start a school?
Started a school.
That's right. I think the school comes to life in Little Men in the sequel to Little Women, doesn't it, as I recollect? Who surprised a school by getting married? Surprised his class, as to say, by getting married. None of you knows that? The answer is Mr. Chips in Goodbye, Mr. Chips. You don't keep up with your contemporary literature as you should, perhaps, gentlemen. That gives us two wrong out of three and sends $25 plus a set of the Encyclopedia Britannica with the good wishes of Lucky Strike to Miss Gilbert of Salinas, California. How about this one, gentlemen? From Jake Browdy of Brighton, Massachusetts. Let's get three out of four on this. Suppose you were managing a squad of Olympic athletes. In which events would you enter each of these, assuming that they were available? The first is Leander. In what event, Dr. McCracken, would you enter Leander?
Swimming.
In swimming, yes. Who was Leander?
Well, he was a Greek mythical hero who swam the Dardanelles.
Yes.
The Hellespont.
The Hellespont. Now, how...
Well, he didn't. He got drowned.
Well, he practically... He did it for some time.
He swam across, but he got drowned on the way back.
Yes, he made it once. We may say that he achieved his objective, his real objective, Mr. Bryson.
But he didn't get home.
He didn't get home, but he got there. How wide is the Hellespont? How much of a feat is that?
About 7 miles, I think, there.
Half a mile.
About 4 miles.
No.
About 4 miles.
Nothing. From Sestos to Abydos was where he swam, and I think that Byron gave it as about 7 miles when he did it. I won't argue the point.
Byron may have, but you know how Byron was. How long did it take Byron to do it? Any idea, Mr. Kieran?
About a page and a half.
That's the space. How about the time? Any idea, Dr. McCracken?
Every time the Odyssey cruise takes place, a lot of college girls swim it every summer.
Apparently it's
before the war.
It's not a difficult thing
it's
to do.
It's less than a mile.
Byron did it. I'm not sure. Did it in an hour? No, he did it in an hour and 10 minutes.
He did.
That's what he
said.
7 miles.
That's wrong.
4 miles. I said four. Couldn't he have done 4 miles in an hour and 10 minutes?
No, I don't think he could.
Well, he left that record anyway, Mr. Kieran. How about Jupiter? Suppose you wanted to enter Jupiter in an Olympic event. What one? Now, Mr. Bryson.
Throwing the javelin.
Very good. Why do you say that?
Because he shot the thunderbolt.
That's exactly right, Mr. Bryson. Very good. Now, how about Pheidippides? Mr. Adams.
In the running.
Yes. Which event particularly, though?
Marathon.
Marathon, yes. He was the famous runner from Marathon to Athens. How long is that, Mr. Kieran?
Well, that was about 40 kilometers. Now the modern distance is 26 miles, 385 yards. But
that's exact to the yard. That's exactly right. And what was the famous sentence that Pheidippides uttered as he reached his goal?
Rejoice, we conquer.
Thank you, Mr. Kieran. That's quite right. Now, how about Atalanta? If you wanted to enter Atalanta, Mr. Kieran.
The sprint.
Yes, the sprint. Women's sprints. Or perhaps men's, for that matter. She did pretty well. Can you, gentlemen, this is from Mrs. E.N. Willis of Dallas, Texas, quote the lines from poetry which begin and end with these words. Get 2 out of 3. These lines begin with the phrase, I stood, and end with the words, church tower. Can you give us everything in between, Mr. Adams?
I stood on the bridge at midnight.
Go ahead. Business-like opening.
As the clock was striking the hour.
Very good.
And the...
Make up a line.
Lump, da, dump, da, dump,
that's dump. The one. I knew we would get that one.
Something on the old church tower.
Yes, that's fine.
I can't do better than that.
Something about the moon.
And the moon.
And the moon rose idly over the city.
Leave out your idly.
And the moon rose over the city.
The moon rose
behind
over the city.
Behind the old church.
Behind the dark church tower. Very good. Now here's another set of openings and endings. Begins a primrose and ends nothing more. Mr. Bryson.
A primrose by the river's bank.
Brim.
A primrose was to him and nothing more.
Oh, you
left wrong.
I left out a line.
Yes. Mr. Adams, what's the second line?
Primrose. Wordsworth wrote it. Let me get that.
That's right. That's quite right, Mr.
A primrose Bryson. By a river's brim.
Yes. And how does it go on?
A yellow primrose was to him, and it was nothing more.
Yes, exactly right. Now, beginning full many and ending desert air. How about that? Mr. Kieran. Good?
Too easy. Full many a gem of purest ray, serene the dark unfathomed caves of ocean bear.
And so it goes. That's quite right. And now Mr. Cross indulges in a bit of frankness.
Ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you very frankly why it will be in your own interest to make that next package of cigarettes you buy Lucky Strike. In a cigarette... It's the tobacco that counts. Better tobacco means a better smoke. And Luckies are made of the finer, the lighter, the naturally milder leaf. You have two proofs of this. First, Luckies are the overwhelming choice of the independent tobacco experts, the world's most impartial judges of tobacco. Second, actual reports from the tobacco markets give you facts and figures to show that the American Tobacco Company pays the price for fine tobacco. For example, we paid 27% more than the market average for tobacco at Cambridge, Virginia last season. 34% more at Mebane, North Carolina. So it goes at market after market. And the best we buy goes into Lucky's. No wonder that with men who know tobacco best, it's Lucky's 2-to-1. Make that next package you buy Lucky Strike.
Thank you, Mr. Cross. This evening, Lucky Strike has cheerfully paid out, or at least it says cheerfully here, $100 and 4 sets of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Thank you, Dr. McCracken and Dr. Bryson, for giving us a chance to educate you this evening. Next week, our Levant-Adams-Kieran combination will be supported, listen carefully, by the irrepressible, undauntable, temperamental, and infinitely variable president of the Brooklyn Dodgers, Mr. Larry MacPhail. Now, remember, for every question we use, whether or not it's answered correctly, the sender gets $10. If the question stumps our experts, you not only get $25 more, but in addition, the complete 24-volume set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Send letters with questions and the correct answers to Information, Please, 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. And now, a parting message from Mr. L.A. Speed Riggs, famous tobacco auctioneer from Goldsboro, North Carolina.
And that chant, ladies and gentlemen, is just another way of saying that if you haven't tried a Lucky lately, you don't know what you're missing. By the way, if you're going visiting this weekend, we suggest you take your host or hostess a carton of Luckies. It's sure to make a hit. Remember, with independent tobacco experts, with men who know tobacco best, it's Lucky's 2-to-1.
This is the National Broadcasting Company.